Mr. Demps, as President of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, how do you manage to find a balance between 47 different countries with different ways of coping with delicate matters such as justice, rule of law, human rights, cybercrime, etc.?
Well, first of all, all 47 countries have ratified the European Convention on human rights and fundamental freedoms. So that is basically the creation of one big legal space. You got more than 840 million people in there. You got the Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg. So by ratifying it, you basically agreed that we share a number of values that account to rule of law, that account to democracy, that account to human rights, that account to fundamental freedom. So you got basically a same base on which you work. Now, obviously, there are a number of different opinions when you go topical on certain issues, but what you do then is you try to find the elements that unite all of these countries, or the most of them, instead of focusing on the matters that divide, which doesn't mean that if you have in a certain country or countries a situation that needs to be addressed, then you do it collectively, you don't do it alone. So once you are inclusive, once you try to get all the opinions on board, and once you are respectful of everyone, that's the basic element that you need in order to run a very diverse parliament, it is not so difficult. I mean, respect for opinion is very important, but at the same time, being firm on the fact that we all respect and adhere to the same values. Mm-hmm. And for example, if the court in Strasbourg has a ruling, that you need to comply with it.
We have an issue with Poland and what has to do with the rule of law. What's your impression from your recent working visit in Poland, and how do you see the future
Well, there's a number of elements in Poland, because of course everyone focuses rightfully so on the fact that the Constitutional Court has made some kind of a ruling that amounts to saying our constitution is above the European Convention. You need to look at the European Convention as kind of a European constitution of fundamental rights, which goes above the national constitutions. So when you're in the Council of Europe, you respect it and you accept it. And so there's no way that a constitutional court can say, now we nationally go over the internationally agreed one. I mean, that is the basic of multilateralism. So I think that this is an evolution which is not so positive, but we need to work on it.
With discussion and persuasion?
Yeah, I mean, I told very clearly when I addressed the Senate, listen, you need to abide with the agreements that you accepted. And so you cannot have a constitutional court on a national level saying that their ruling goes over the international one because you ratified the convention. I was very clear on that. Now, this accounts on the independence of the judiciary in Poland, which is a very sensitive matter. But that was not the only thing that we addressed. I saw that on the topic of violence against women, the Istanbul Convention, there was some talk about it in Poland.
Which is, of course, a problem.
Yeah, well, not really, because we had a Grevio report. Grevio is like the organ that assesses a country. And the evolution in Poland was positive. And I had a meeting with the Minister of Family Affairs, who was very clear. There's no way that we're going to touch the Istanbul Convention because it has an added value for us. Because that's the basic of multilateralism. It is like you address an issue together. I mean, you cannot address migration alone. You cannot address COVID alone. You cannot address refugees alone. You cannot address environment alone. You do it collectively. And as a matter of fact, in terms of violence against women, you learn from each other. How do you cope with it best? How do you go against it best? And that is the value of an international convention, such as the Istanbul Convention, and they know it.
It's not very respected by Turkish
Well, just if you go into Turkey, yes, Mr. Erdogan withdrew, which is his right. Okay, this is not a binding. I mean, you're not supposed to, not all 47 countries are obliged to get into it. And if you're into it, you can get out. I think he made a mistake. I told him that also personally. But to give you one example, the head of the national delegation, who is of the party of Mr. Erdogan, freely and openly in our assembly says that he is in favor of the Istanbul Convention and that he would like to return back into it. See, so this is ongoing work. So you don't go bashing out and lashing out and shaming and blaming all the time. It might be needed sometimes, but you try to empower people who are on the positive note. Let me give you another example on Poland, because you addressed Poland in the first time. We'll get back to Turkey if you wish so. But the whole situation at the border, right? with Belarus, who is absolutely into human trafficking. I see now that the European Union is taking that also as a stance. Thank you for that. It is human trafficking. So address it in a multilateral, global way. Don't leave Poland alone, because then they have the logic of protecting their border, although basically they're protecting the outer border, in this case, of the European Union. Again, added value of multilateralism is addressing a terrible problem together, because then you're more strong to do so. Mm-hmm. And so in Poland, I see a lot of powers in opposition, in majority, that want to go in the right direction. What you do have in Poland, as in a number of countries, you've got a number of strong persons who have their own opinion, which is not necessarily a good opinion, and it influences the political world, okay? So, but my view is you better empower people who want to do good instead of only having a big finger up there and saying, oh, you're bad. But, okay, this is a question of how you address an issue.
As we are talking about issues, an issue is refugee crisis. Mm-hmm. Are you afraid for a new refugee crisis due to the situation in Afghanistan? What's the role of Turkey in what has to do with Afghanistan?
First of all,
is this a matter that has countries over the south have to be worried about?
Well, first of all, you're never afraid of anything, because if you're only afraid, you don't get anywhere, right? As I said just a minute ago, a refugee issue is not an issue that you address alone. That's impossible. Is it going to be a risk to Europe? Obviously, yes. This is why we had the big debate on Afghanistan, because we see that the way the Taliban are addressing the society, it will obviously fuel refugees, mm-hmm. not only from Afghanistan, but from other parts of the world. And refugees, I mean, ones that values are hurt, I mean, you have to consider these people. They're human beings. They just want to have a better life and not being bashed by their own authorities. Mm-hmm. This is why, for example, in the Council of Europe, in our assembly, again, we said, if now all 47 countries together address it and say, listen, our relationship with Afghanistan will only be a decent and a good one if they adhere to certain elements of decency in terms of managing their country, in terms of democracy, in terms of respecting women, by the way, in that country, then you have impact. If it's only one or two doing so, you don't have impact. Coming to Turkey or other countries...
You know, refugees have been used by Turkey as a tool in the past towards our borders.
This is a position you take, right? I mean, mm-hmm. this is not a question. This is you say Turkey has. No. My opinion on Turkey is that it's a complex situation. Of course, the refugee issue has been politically used. Why? Because the whole Europe wanted the refugees to stay in Turkey, mm-hmm. and they paid an immense amount of money for it. So basically, that way, it became a political issue. I'm not going to say who's right or wrong. I am saying that on a multilateral basis, you should address it, and you should be inclusive with Turkey and any other countries to address it in a good way. Mm-hmm. If you only stand up, as some
so
do, and cry out and
say... become more tolerant in all European countries.
No. That's not being tolerant. It is addressing the issue the way it should be addressed. It is putting responsibilities where they should be it Turkey or any other country of the Council of Europe 47 member states. Mm-hmm. Or as a matter of fact, of course, I do not speak on behalf of the European Union,
yes.
but maybe the European Union should also have like some kind of a policy where they in some way address it rightfully and try to cope with it by maybe having every country do his duty, which is not the case today in the European mm-hmm. Union. Council of Europe is broader. As you know, this is 47 countries, not 27. But again, in our assembly, we did address it from a 47 country point of view, that all of us need to do what is, I mean, a refugee is something that you have to, I mean, we are human beings. You don't run away because you want to run away. It's because there's a terrible thing happening in your country. So you have to do two things. You have to address, let's say, what is happening, but you also have to address why it is happening. You know, the most important question in politics is not what's happening, you know. It is, why is it happening? Mm-hmm. And you address the why. If you have refugees, address the reason why they became refugees. And this is not enough. I mean, policy or politics do not do this enough. And this is what we try to do in the Parliament Assembly. Of course, we do not have impact, aside from the fact that we can ask all of our members of Parliament who sit in our Parliament to go in their 47 parliaments and put it on the table. A lot of them are doing that. This is what we can do. The second
thing... But others know.
No. And if I put a question to a minister in my country on the refugee issue, he better answer, or he has a problem. If everyone would do that in the 47 parliaments, then we would have impact. It's staying away from the problem, you don't solve anything.
Which is the biggest risk for democracy due to the sanitary crisis of COVID-19?
I think the biggest risk is that you create a new normal, that because of the fact that the COVID had an enormous impact, it's got to do with life, right? So many people unfortunately died from it. I think the biggest risk is that now national authorities needed to address it on a national basis. Curfews, limiting freedoms, no one can get out of its house, what have you. The risk is that if this becomes kind of a new normal, then you will have national authorities saying, oh, this is nice. I mean, I can control my people. And at the end of the day, maybe I can control them so far that the next elections I will always win. Mm-hmm. So this is, in my view, one of the biggest risks, that because of the fact that every country in the beginning had to go back to itself and try to manage it and forgot that you need to do it on a multilateral basis, which is happening now, by the way, that is, to my feeling, democracy, to my feeling, is at risk because of COVID. Now, what we've done in the Assembly, together with the Secretary General and together with the Committee of Ministers, we set out some guidelines saying, if you take measures, they should stop when COVID is over. They should be proportional. Don't overdo it. You should not be following people with some kind of a tracking system for other reasons than because of the COVID potential transmission. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are the guidelines that we put out, and most of the countries are really following them.
Do you see any divisions between the Europeans because of the vaccination and the discussion if it has to be obligatory or not?
Well, we have a position as an assembly. The assembly has said very clearly it cannot be obligatory, but it would be wise to get vaccinated. It's a difficult one. Mm-hmm. This is like the difficult discussion between how far does freedom go, a fundamental freedom, and how far can an authority impose something on you. So the principle, let's say the position that we've taken, is saying, listen, you cannot enforce it, but you should, to 100%, if possible, try to have people be vaccinated, because it's not about yourself, it is about the potential risk for the people around you. On the COVID passport, that's a different issue. There is, like, you have the risk of creating two kind of people, right? Mm-hmm. You have a COVID passport, you can do whatever you like. You don't have it, and you cannot. I believe that it is to a certain level, it is justified, because you can get vaccinated if you want to. There's another problem, is that not all the vaccines are recognized, for example, in the European Union, mm-hmm. right? So you got vaccines that they have bought. You've got other vaccines that are recognized by the WHO. They all should get into the vaccine passport if you want to apply it. In my own country, of course, the regions, I'm Belgian, so we've got three regions.
Yes. Yeah?
And so they've got a different policy on that. On the basis of what? On the basis of the fact that in one region, we are vaccinated largely over 70 to 80%. And so you can be more free instead of imposing passports, as in, for example, the capital, where unfortunately, due to the international character of it, it doesn't go so well. So mm-hmm. there you impose. So you need to, public health is by far the first thing you have to look at. But again, we do not, as an assembly, give an advice that you have to impose vaccines, but we clearly say you should better do it. And if you get into the COVID passport issue, obviously, if you refuse yourself to take a vaccine, you shouldn't be surprised then at the end of the day, well, that you have another situation in society than the ones who did.
Mm-hmm. How do you see our common future in what has to do with the environment? You have an activity, environment, right now, but it's not only up to Europeans. It's up to United States, up to China, etc.
Well, you have to start somewhere. Huh? And again, climate, environment is not something that you can address alone. It's been one of my, if maybe the most important priority that I put on the table beginning of last year, because my view on the issue is that as long as environment stays at the level of policy, I've been a minister long enough to know policy means that you go debating with your colleagues who gets how much money to do what. So as long as you keep environment on the level of policy, you'll always have a debate, and it never will go principally really full throttle, if you wish, to defend and to turn around the situation that we have, which is terrible. And so what I've put on the table is saying you have to elevated to the level of a principle. Mm-hmm. Environment is a human right. Article 2 of the convention says you and I and everyone in the room, we have the right to live. But under which conditions? I mean, if it isn't in a clean, safe, healthy, sustainable environment, what is life worth? So you need to put it in the convention and make it a principal issue set on the policy level. You don't debate it anymore, whether it's necessary or not. And this is what we've done. So this is exactly what we've done. We created a real paradigm shift by having our recommendations, which is basically, what is a recommendation? You impose on the governments to answer your demands. Mm-hmm. They answer what they wish. But I believe that they have understood that it is really important that environment is a human right. And at the end of the day, you know, and this is what I wanted to see happen. I don't know if we can get there. But the remarks I got when I came with the idea of putting it in the convention itself, then people said, Rick, but do you know what you're saying? Now people can go to court in Strasbourg, and the court in Strasbourg, they basically can judge a country. I said, but that's exactly what I want. As long as people have no right to really go to Strasbourg and say, you government are not doing what you're supposed to do to protect me, my family, my friends, right. The whole country, mm-hmm. my right, as long as that doesn't exist, they will not move enough. And so we're starting to get there. I hope we can get there. It is harsh, but at the end of the day, I mean, if you don't have a big enough stick to have governments move, and again, I'm being a long-time minister, I know what it means, a big stick and a carrot, of course, also, is what you need. And another thing that I wanted to mention on the environment, this is now for the first time in, what, 10, 15 years, that if we as a political world engage into it, we can reconnect with all these young people. We've got millions of young people in the streets, rightfully so, saying, you old buggers, you're responsible. And they're right. There's a lot of reasons for it, but they are right. So reconnect with the young people, get them on board, and together you can then have enough force to put it in the convention and to have governments move. Reconnect with the young people. Again, it is inclusive instead of exclusive. And I can say that as far as I'm concerned, at least on this issue, a lot of these youngsters that I've seen, I mean, they are quite enthusiastic and they want to go together with us to make it happen. So. Connect back to young people, address the issue itself, make it a principal issue, another policy issue. This is what we try to do from the Council of Europe, from the Assembly at least, from the Parliamentary mm-hmm. Assembly. And at the end of the day, it's all about standard setting on a multilateral basis. Do it together, address it together, all 47, and then you can have impact.
What has to do with an energy crisis? An energy crisis can create new divisions between people.
Energy, you know, is a different debate. You've got these very large companies who make a lot of money, rightfully so or wrongfully so, I'm not debating that, by producing energy. If you got a big investment lying there and then they say you have to shut it down, of course that's got a certain effect to the companies itself. Many of them are public, many of them are private. But as long as you keep old energy technology working, there will be no room for new ones. I mean, I've studied business administration, what have you. Mm-hmm. This is more than 30 years ago, okay? At those days already, they showed us like all the new techniques, aside from nuclear energy and aside from coal and what have you. I mean, there's an whole area of new techniques that have never developed. Why? Because the weight of the old techniques didn't allow that they grew. So my belief, but this is a personal stance, this has not been in the Assembly, you need to give room to new technologies and then it can happen. I'll give you one example again from my country. We have put these eoliennes, you know, these big turning wheels, well, whatever, in the sea. We now, within this and a couple of years, if there is enough wind at the time, we can provide for the energy of the whole country by setting so many in the sea. That's new technology. So we have to go away from the old technology into the new technology, but it means that you have to have the courage to stop the old ones. Mm-hmm. And that might mean a budgetary effort, that might mean whatever, and it is wrong to think that you will lose jobs, because that's what they say. I mean, if new technology would destroy jobs, then we would all be out of a job now, because we, over the last 20, 30, 40 years, we have seen a lot of new technologies come in so many different areas. We need to do it also in energy now.
I don't know how many people know that you are a painter and a wine trader. How can you influence in a creative way the members of the Council of Europe?
Mm. Well, I'm not a wine trader, I'm a winemaker.
Maker,
yes.
Okay.
And it's true that I'm a lot into art. I think the added value of that is that it allows you to look at things from a different angle and add to that some out-of-the-box creativity. I'll give you an example. I mean, I got this middle... Politics, you know, is very, let's say, bi-dimensional, right? It's like very binary. You're good, I'm bad. Now, if you look at this bottle, and I'll show it to the camera, you know, if you look at it like that, it's some kind of a rectangle with a little top on it. When you turn it around, it's a circle. Mm-hmm. Now, when you turn it like that, it's a circle with a small circle. I'll tell you how politics works. One party will say it's a rectangular, and the other one will say it's a circle, and then the third one will say it's a circle with a small circle, and they'll fight like hell over it. Mm-hmm. But they're all talking about the same thing. And so what an artist does is say, hey, guys and ladies, why don't you take it and look at it from the different angles and try to find a solution? Then what hits in is creativity. Then you have to go out of the box. Don't look at things the way you looked at it for the last 10, 20 years. Look at it in a fresh, new, completely different way. That is what an artist can do in politics.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.